CEO of Kronos Pharma. We're a CRO that prides itself on staying abreast of new developments in clinical trial design. Thus, I'm happy to speak on the subject of master protocols, which is undoubtedly becoming a disruptive concept that may lead to a paradigm shift in how we conduct clinical trials in the future. In 2006, the unprecedented approval of imatinib, which many of us know as Gleevec, for 5 new indications based on a single phase 2 clinical trial bewildered the pharmaceutical market. The FDA not only approved a drug without the customary 2 pivotal phase 3 trials, the drug was also cleared to treat a record number of cancers, 1 solid and 4 hematologic. It was an open-label, single-arm prospective study that enrolled just 186 patients with 40 malignancies that expressed imatinib-sensitive tyrosine kinases. In 5 of 40 malignancies, the responses were so robust that it became the genesis for the NDA applications and subsequent approvals. Many consider this trial to be the origin of master protocols. It is important to mention, however, that this study remained an outlier in terms of the number of rules and the paucity of patients that were needed. Thus, if you plan a master protocol study, these aren't the numbers that you should be penciling in. So what is a master protocol? It is a unifying trial protocol that includes multiple subgroups and substudies with patients having same or different diseases and that employ one or multiple drugs to treat it. Initially designed for oncology, master protocol trials are intended to simultaneously evaluate more than one investigational drug against one or more disease types with the same overall trial structure. Its idea is to bring multiple pharma and medtech companies together into a single ecosystem. Conceptually, it signifies a new collaborative approach to clinical trial research. There are 3 types: master protocols, basket, umbrella, and platform, and we'll discuss each one of them separately. Basket design is a study type where a single therapeutic is used to treat multiple disease entities, usually within the same field of medicine. The Gleevec study that was mentioned at the beginning is an example of a basket trial. In such trials, patients are divided into parallel cohorts. Cohorts with robust responses may be expanded to achieve statistical significance, and the ones that do not have a response are dropped. This approach is otherwise called drop the loser, pick the winner. Umbrella design is the antithesis of basket trial design. Here, more than one targeted therapy is studied for a single disease. Patients are divided into multiple parallel treatment arms, receiving different drugs or drug combinations. Such studies usually include a control arm as well. Basket design is well suited for oncology, where different drugs can target different mutations in a single type of cancer. Some of the examples include Winther, Battle, and Sefiro trials. However, it can be very useful in other fields, such as in infectious diseases, where multiple antibacterials or antiviral drugs can be used to treat the same infectious process. Platform design, also known as adaptive platform trial, is the most complicated type of master protocol. Here, multiple treatments for a single disease are employed, and these treatments are allowed to enter and exit based on the decision algorithm. Platform trials have some similarities with umbrella trials in that a single condition is usually studied throughout multiple interventions. However, unlike umbrella trials, where all the subgroups go the initial predefined distance irrespective of the outcome, in platform trials, the information generated early in the trial is used to adjust its subsequent flow. The main tools utilized by platform trials include the use of response adaptive randomization rules to preferentially assign interventions that perform more favorably, rules to trigger the additional termination of a study arm, or rules to transition from earlier study phase to later phase. As data accrue from enrolled patients, they're used to iteratively update a pre-specified model. The updated results of the model trigger threshold for termination of a futile cohort and provide updated randomization instructions for the ongoing arms. In theory, a platform design study can continue indefinitely and without interruptions. Now let's take a look at a couple of case studies for master protocols. The first one is the GBM Agile trial, which is an international phase 2-3 clinical trial of adult patients with newly diagnosed or recurrent isocitrate dehydrogenase wild-type glioblastoma multiforme. The first patient was enrolled in July of 2019 with a plan to recruit over 3,000 patients worldwide. The study will have two stages, an adaptively randomized learn stage to identify effective interventions and associated biomarker-defined signatures with a seamless integration to a fixed randomized conform stage for interventions that show positive signals of efficacy. The primary endpoint of GBM Agile is overall survival, and the statistically significant data from the second phase, the conform phase of the study, will be used for new drug applications. The REMAP CAP is an international phase 4 platform design clinical trial evaluating multiple standards of care, treatments and its combination, and experimental treatment options for adults diagnosed with severe community-acquired pneumonia. The design of REMAP CAP allows to simultaneously assess for multiple interventions. If patients are ineligible for randomization into one subgroup, they are immediately evaluated for other subgroups. REMAP CAP is launching in four domains that examine different antibiotics, the use of steroids, and the use of different ventilation strategy. The study is designed in a way that additional interventions within each subgroup, as well as additional subgroups, can be added. It is enrolling in multiple geographies with plans to evaluate and address both standard of care and real-life differences in community-acquired pneumonia management. As mentioned earlier, master protocols are truly a paradigm shift, and those are high-complexity trials, thus they frequently require third-party management. They may also be considered time-consuming in both its design, preparation, and execution. They purposely include multiple interim analyses that increase the study duration and somewhat paradoxically may require larger patient cohorts. In addition, it's unlikely that a single company would have enough drug candidates with similar indications and at the same time have them in the same stage of development to warrant the use of this model. There are also issues surrounding a competition and control whereby individual companies may be unwilling to create a platform study which may benefit its direct competitors. As to date, all of the master protocol trials have been run by independent organizations, mostly nonprofits, government agencies, or the combinations thereof. Other considerations include the fact that these new designs are often reminiscent of head-to-head comparisons, which are superiority trials, which are not always palatable for risk-averse pharmaceutical companies. In situations where the plan is to compare one drug candidate to one standard of care regimen, it may be easier to run a classic randomized control trial. Funding for master protocol trials can also be challenging, as these trials are frequently open-ended and perpetual, without a set number of patients, with unclear duration of interventions, and are subject to evolving standards of care. Potential variance in budgets associated with these trials may be unattractive for pharmaceutical companies and other parties accustomed to strict budgetary constraints, who may prefer the relative predictability of transitional designs. With this said, the benefits of master protocols are obvious and vast. Firstly, time savings. The test hypothesis can quickly and effectively be executed, allows for faster activation of new studies and sub-studies by plugging into existing infrastructures and cohorts. The potential cost savings come from cost sharing of startup and site recruitment, site monitoring, administration, and control arms. In master protocols, leading research and clinical experts in the area of complex and difficult to treat diseases share latest evidence more so than in any other trial design. To patients, master protocols mean reduction of the placebo exposure from the customary 1-to-1 ratio to 1-to-5 or even 1-to-10, which means that more treatment options are available and given to the patients who now have more shots on goal. Master protocols mean wide collaboration between investigators and help to collect observational data, create natural history cohorts, and quickly test clinical hypotheses. Patient advocacy groups are enabled to accelerate translation of preclinical research into novel treatments for the patient groups that they represent. There's clearly a rising tide in favor of complex, innovative trial designs, with several international governing bodies recently cementing their endorsement. In 2019, the FDA affirmed its position regarding two complex study designs by issuing guidance on master protocols. The same year, the EU Heads of Medicines agencies launched guidance to support the adoption of complex trial design, recognizing the fact that the development of personalized medicine is gaining ground and clinical trials are becoming, quote-unquote, more complex. In January 2020, in the UK, the National Institute of Health Research put forward recommendations to support further development and adoption of complex innovative design trials, including master protocol trials. These moves suggest a groundswell of support for the wider adoption of complex design trials beyond oncology and into previously hard-to-treat conditions. It is likely that the demand for innovative design trials is growing in tandem with the shift towards biomarker-driven precision medicine. Thus, there is a good possibility that many of us will soon be mastering the master protocol trials. I would like to thank everyone for listening to this presentation and hope that you found it useful. Please feel free to contact us should you have any questions or if you need services of a premier mid-sized CRO that can design and execute the most effective clinical trials and do it with the highest quality and in record time. Again, thank you very much.